David Goad, fund manager at Emin de Rothschild Asset Management, where he helps oversee about $13 billion in assets, joins us this morning right here in our Hong Kong studio. Good to have you back on the program,
good
David.
Morning, Suzanne.
So, QE3, yes or no?
No. I mean, basically, my sense that, you know, it's always difficult to predict monetary policy decisions and also the GDP momentum. But if you look at some structural indicators, and one that I'm very simply using is the manufacturing job creation in the U.S., and if you look since the 90s, it's been coming down very sharply from 18 million jobs down to 11 million jobs. And since 2010, it's been actually recovering. We are now back to 12 million. So one may say it's not enough, but at the same time, this is a real sign of recovery, and that may not need actually to see further liquidity injection.
Okay, so no liquidity injection, but we just had a guest who used to work at the U.S. Treasury saying that he wouldn't be surprised if Operation Twist continued after June 30th. Does that seem more realistic to you?
That's possible. That's very possible, but frankly, it's hard to have a clear view at that, in that respect. But I'm not worried about the structural and the basis of the U.S. economy at this stage.
Okay. What are you worried about? Europe, I assume?
Still, yeah, of course. Although I found the ECB actually a lot more proactive. If you look at how they've been, and they continue to be supportive to the Eurozone banking sector, it's actually very encouraging. I'm also very positively surprised by their decision to focus now on growth on top of controlling inflation.
But the UK is in double dip mode, David.
It is, but you know, the whole world has been slowing down. I mean, if you look at the GDP in China, the momentum also has been decelerating. Now the case is that if it is just temporary and cyclical, if the bases are still quite strong, then we're probably going to see some sense of recovery.
Okay, so it seems like there is only one bright spot right now, which is the U.S. I mean, earnings, 80% of beating estimates, and you know, consumers are spending, though, as you mentioned, manufacturing still flat on its back, given the durable goods order. So do you just go ahead and buy into the U.S.? Is that the only place to be right now?
Well, not only the U.S. I mean, if you look at consumption overall across the region in Asia, it's been extremely resilient. And the numbers that's coming out, even in the first quarter, are quite strong. We see weakness in the cyclical names. We see weakness in the financial names. But then again, you know, our basic scenario, and if we talk about China more specifically, is that this first quarter will be a trough in terms of GDP growth in China. You're going to see gradual recovery, and along with that, you're going to start to see cyclical performing. And, you know, to me, it's not a surprise that all markets actually are not doing that bad. You're making money so far this year.
You are making money so far this year, but, you know, to me, it looks like the gains have been petering out after what we've hit almost May at this point, and people are starting to shut down their books. I mean, they're still pretty hesitant to get into the markets and go full steam.
They are. But, you know, at some point, valuation will talk to people again. And when you look at valuation, and I'm talking again about China, and because we are positive on China moving forward.
But what are you doing in the markets? I mean, are you buying?
We are fully invested right now. So we don't see actually massive inflow at this stage, but it will have to come at some point. Let me just give you one element. The Eurozone financial firms last year have been removing money away from Asia because they have to consolidate their balance sheet. Now, for these firms, at least for the LCO one, the key question now is, do I want to continue to lose market share in Asia, because they are losing market share at the expense of domestic firms? If they don't actually reallocate some of their balance sheet to Asia very soon, they're going to miss on that recovery and that growth.
So you're saying buy Asia. Is that what you're saying right now?
Sorry?
Are you saying buy Asia? Is that
yes,
what you're saying right now?
I'm definitely positive on the Asian outlook. And I think in terms of flow, it's just a matter of time. Valuation is there. The fundamentals are improving. Yes, people have to be cautious because of the Eurozone situation. But once we pass and people get more comfortable, where are you going to reallocate your extra money? You know, where are you going to take the extra risk? That's going to be in
Asia. What are you buying in Asia?
We've been actually massively positioned on the consumer names. They're not cheap, but they are delivering. They are delivering constantly. So they are the core portfolio. And then, you know, we're starting to look very seriously at lagging cyclicals, because first quarter results were very poor for the petrochem sector, poor for the life insurance segment. You know, China Life numbers are not great. But if one takes a view that China is going to gradually recover, then, you know, it's a great entry point for those names. And valuation are attractive.
Yes, so some of the names that you like, China Life, Liam Fung, Sinopec, might be something.
Yeah, we continue to like those names.
And
Buy
Giordano.
Into those names.
Have you shopped Giordano before?
Yes, I do.
Really?
I do with my kids. So, I like the brand positioning and the pricing positioning. And the balance sheet, the quality of the management, and the yield. You know, it's a 5% yield.
Can't beat that, right? David, thank you so much for dropping
by today.
Thanks. And, you know, it's Thursday, but heading into the weekend, I hope you have a good one. David
Goad
there of Emin de Rothschild.